attempt to adjust the picture. We are controlling transmission. We will control the horizontal. We will control the vertical. We can change the focus to a soft blur, or sharpen it to crystal clarity. For the next hour, think quietly and we will control all that you see and hear. You are about to participate in a great adventure. You are about to experience the awe and mystery which reaches from the inner mind to the outer limits.
Do you want to play it or anything?
It might be.
You're never going to reach that. The refried beans. Yeah, I'll bring a spoon.
Don't worry about any kind of mess. I've got no qualms about a mess or anything. How is it? Where's my chicken?
It's over there.
You fucker.
I thought you were grabbing your chicken.
All right, and with that, welcome to Sequel Podcast. That's my thing. That's what I've been doing. I've been pre-gaming it and then jumping in, and people are like, what? We were recording that? So I'm Matt Bonta.
I'm Greg Kleino.
And this is one of our Halloween-themed, hopefully Halloween-themed podcast. Me and Dakota kind of got off topic.
It's all right.
It is all right. That's what these are for. These are for fun, hanging out, and just catching up. And for the listening audience, we made a five-layer dip. We've got refried beans, salsa, guacamole, sour cream, and shredded cheese.
And it's quite delicious.
And we each have a whole rotisserie chicken, too.
Which I'm going to mow down right now.
So, you know, we'll see how it goes. We'll see if we last the rest of the podcast.
See how much mouth noises we get in here.
It'll probably be a very disgusting episode. With that, I've got a couple of topics. But we'll just BS while we're talking for the moment.
All right.
Since it's a horror themed, I don't want, like, you know, we're eating at the same time and everything like that. I went and saw Insidious Chapter 2.
How was that?
It was scary. It was pretty fucking scary. I told this to Dakota, too, so I don't want to retread too much, but...
I heard one of my other friends saw it, and they said that it was so horrible compared to the first one.
Like, it wasn't as good quality as the first one?
Yeah.
I hadn't seen the first one in like two, three years, however long, 2 years. So it obviously didn't stick with me too much because I didn't really remember.
Yeah.
But I thought there was there was definitely some really scary parts in it.
Good, good. Everybody loves a scary movie.
I don't think that Insidious Chapter, the first one, was all that good up until the end when he goes... Did you see the first one?
I have not.
Oh,
I
what the fuck, dude?
I have been living by myself for the last couple months, and I'm a wuss when the lights are turned off, so.
Well, that's okay, because Dakota borrowed it last night, so he's got it at the moment.
Now, it's the same makers as Paranormal Activity, right?
It's the same makers as Saw. Saw and Dead Silence.
Oh, okay.
I believe the dude that made Paranormal Activity is a producer on it.
Oh, okay.
Because when me and Dakota went and saw Evil Dead, like, all it was all horror trailers in front of it, and, like, every single one of them said, either from the makers of Saw and Insidious, or Paranormal Activity and Insidious.
Mm.
So it's like, I guess that's where our horror genre is at nowadays, is it's these guys.
They're low budgeters, too.
They are. They're very low budgeters.
Which is, I think, awesome. I mean,
cost effective,
getting away from the big budget studios that just never turn out all that amazing.
You know what? I can't even really think of the last studio horror movie.
It's a good trivia question.
No one listens, but if anyone's listening and you know the answer, What's one of the couple of the most recent big budget horror movies? I really can't think of any.
Remake of The Thing?
I mean, maybe. But that was like a couple years ago. There's got to be at least one like within the last year.
Yeah.
You know, The Thing might have been Universal.
Mm-hmm.
Because The Thing is Universal.
John Carpenter's.
A Universal picture.
Johnny Carps.
John Carps. So this is Dark Meat on the drumstick, right?
Yeah. And I love Dark Meat.
I don't like it, but this is pretty good.
Yeah.
Like the Blues Brothers here. A whole chicken. Yeah, we're not going to reach those refried beans, dude.
I reached it right here.
I'm going to dig.
Just dig it. It can be a 5-layer dip and then just mix it all together. It tastes the same, right?
I don't know about that.
That'll be my new thing. Make like a 5-layer dip or even a 12-layer dip and then just mix it all together.
It's like the Kleino.
Yeah.
I was thinking about that the other day. That summer, there was always a party that had crackers.
The party tray.
The party tray.
So for those of you listening who don't know what the Kleino is, because obviously it's so popular.
It's been lost in obscurity.
When you go to a party, and there's a party tray of all sorts of snacks, knick-knack snacks, crackers, cheese, and, you know, all the veggies and stuff. What you do, it's a food group that we invented called the Snackwich. And what you do is you go up to the party tray, and you just take whatever's in front of you, put it all together in one snackwich, and
something you can barely fit your mouth over.
Yeah, just stick it in your mouth and
try not to choke.
Yeah, and the first one I made was we called it the Kleino.
Called it the Kleino. It was like a cracker. It's
cracker,
cheese,
salsa,
a carrot
dipped in ranch, and I think that was
another
whole thing.
Cracker. Was there a piece of meat on there? A salami, a summer sausage.
No.
I don't think so.
Just
either.
The cheese.
Yeah.
We still have to write a book about it, me and Ty. The Snackwich book.
The Snackwich.
Which has
coffee table book,
blank pages in it to insert your own creations.
That sounds so light. Sounds like a cop out.
And then
to make money.
The Kleino 2.0, where it's the same thing, only you dip the cracker in caramel.
I don't know about that.
It's delicious.
With the cheese,
yeah.
And the no.
Yeah. Is there broccoli on it? There might be broccoli on it as well.
No, there was no broccoli.
The chasm, the chasm has broccoli on it.
Oh, okay. There's another thing.
The chasm is celery stick, and then what was it called?
The
cocktail
cheese?
Sauce.
Oh gosh,
celery stick, cocktail sauce, part of a boiled egg. And a shrimp. A cold shrimp.
What does that mean, part of a boiled egg?
Like
a little bit of white, a little bit of yolk?
Yeah, like cut in half.
Okay. A slice of hard boiled egg.
Slice of hard boiled egg. And that's the fancy one.
Where'd you make this one at?
That one was at Summer's house. Summer Austin Rasmussen. I think your graduation party. They all came from graduation parties.
Yes. Yes. I am making a mess. Like the line on Arrested Development, I'm having an affair with this ice cream sandwich.
I had ice cream last night. It was nice. We were at Ty's house and we walked to the gas station. It was one of the first cold nights in Reno. And, of course, I was in shorts and a t-shirt. Everybody else was in
pants
and hoodies.
Pants?
And I'm walking back. I'm sitting there eating some ice cream. And it was delicious. But I started to get cold.
I'm loving it, dude. I was telling you that earlier. I wasn't telling the audience that, so I'm saying it again. I'm loving the cold.
Autumn, fall is my favorite season.
I don't want it to get colder than this. I heard it was snowing in Mount Rose today.
Hmm. Makes sense, since it's raining down here.
Kind of a scary thought.
Go snowboarding tomorrow. First day of fall.
Yeah. What? Do you remember when we were we were filming Dutch, and we were up at Lake Tahoe in June.
I remember that.
And you were like, you can tell people, right, but there was snow on the mountain. You're like, oh, you can tell people you're playing in the snow in June.
Yeah.
It was awesome. Holy shit.
It was a rough day of filming.
Yeah. As Greg is wont to do. Want to have rough days of filming.
It's so fun when you get up there, you throw up a couple of times, do a couple of takes, throw up some more.
You're noticeably, I guess, agitated in the scene. It's definitely there.
I was acting.
You're acting sick. Acting not sick.
You just said my acting sick, man? Awesome.
Acting sick. Yeah, Greg just pointed out, I've written on the monitor here, check the microphone.
Did you get, like, halfway through a podcast once with the microphone turned off?
I made it through a whole podcast and even read through a script with Olivia and Jeff.
And the microphone was turned off?
No, it was this microphone that I pushed back behind here.
Oh.
And I thought we were recording on this one.
So you recorded on the webcam microphone.
And the podcast sounds like shit, but you could hear what we're saying.
Yeah.
But then the script that we read through, it's impossible.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, I started editing it, and I was like, there's no way.
Mm.
And it was good, too.
Oh, yeah. I was just talking to Jeff about that last night.
About?
The toilet monster.
Oh, because he was reading it.
Mm-hmm.
What was said in this discussion?
Well, as he was playing a demon thing.
He was like, I was a shit demon over at Matt's place.
Like, I just read for that. We did our podcast, and, well, he called it an interview.
You know what? He was playing it off like it was an interview when we podcasted, too.
Yeah.
I was like, are you talking to somebody else here? And did a question get asked that I didn't say? No, if that makes sense now that you say that. All right, so go ahead.
But he's, he had me read the script right after it, and it was pretty cool. And, hopefully we get some more of that.
Yeah, we have to do it again, so.
Well, he will be down to do it again.
It was a lot of fun because he did the Deuce Demon with a British accent, and it was so funny.
Mm-hmm.
And fucked up. And I was doing, like, surfer dude, bro. I was bro.
What's up, bro?
And then he was also the radio DJ.
Oh, okay.
Oh, and the net, like, he read the blocking, too.
Oh, okay, cool. Starting in on the sequel productions radio plays.
Basically unused scripts that we never filmed.
Mm-hmm. Which a lot of them are horror, so that works out for this podcast.
You know, it's funny. When I was trying to drum up word of mouth for the movie premiere at work,
mm-hmm.
There's this one chick that I talked to that likes horror movies.
Yeah.
And I used to talk to her about horror movies before I left, and I was like, oh yeah, you should come see the movie. And she was just like, you know, like she couldn't make it, blah, 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 whatever.
Excuses.
Yeah, yeah. And she was like, oh, is it horror? And I was like, no, it's not. I felt really disappointed having to say that because I'm a horror guy and you know,
mm-hmm.
we haven't really made a horror movie yet.
Yeah, it's all been crime drama. Next one, though, is a... It's sort of horror.
It's on the line.
Yeah.
I ran down the basic, not really the basic, the specifics of it with Dakota.
Mm-hmm.
Super stoked. Super stoked about it.
Nice.
Like, I told him, like, the twists in it.
Yeah.
He almost shit himself. He thought it was so awesome.
Is he going to get in on pre-production with this one?
Whatever he's willing to do. I was telling him, you know, just to make sure that we get it right, it'll probably be a longer pre-production.
Yeah.
Than I was originally thinking. I get ideas in my head and I get super excited and I want to just get started right away.
Yeah.
We barely have a script at this moment, so. But yeah, no, just to make sure we get everything right, You know, me and Melissa went over some costume stuff and prom stuff.
Do everything right. Do all the design beforehand. Get a shot list together. Possibly do some storyboarding.
Definitely need to get our locations down. We may even have to build something.
Yeah.
Nothing too crazy. Just a makeshift shack.
Yeah.
Or find one. Definitely probably go back and shoot where you guys shot the torture scene.
Yeah.
That's an ideal location.
Out in the Verdi.
Out in the Verdi.
That might have been California. It's like, oh shit, it's right on the border, if not in California.
Were you out by where you filmed the beach driving scenes?
Yeah.
For Pedro Zombie?
Yeah.
With that Taco Bell?
Yeah, it's right on, it's basically 3-4 minutes up the road from Taco Bell.
That shit's so ridiculous because you're driving and she's shooting Jeannie in the back seat. Oh no, there's Patrick and AJ walking.
Yeah. Who are those guys? Walking on the road.
It's so funny. It's one, I don't know, like, I would love to see that one with an audience. Although Patrick gets a little racist in it.
Yeah.
Actually a lot more racist than I realized.
Quite a bit racist.
But, like, I would love to see that one with an audience.
Yeah.
You know, I'm wondering if it would play as an audience movie because... Is it only funny because we know these people?
Mm-hmm.
Or is it funny because it's funny?
Yeah.
There's meat on the bottom, Greg.
Oh, there's so much meat on the bottom of the chicken. Ugh.
So gross, dude.
Oh, I love it.
I've been, to keep on topic with horror, have you seen the Silence of the Lambs movies? The Hannibal Lecter ones?
I've only seen Silence of the Lambs. I have not seen Hannibal or Red Dragon.
Or Manhunter or Hannibal Rising.
Or those ones. I've not seen the TV show either.
Oh, shit, that's right. I keep forgetting about that TV show. It's got the dude from Casino Royale.
Mm-hmm.
But I've read Hannibal Rising, watched the movie, then I started reading Hannibal, watched that movie, started watching Red Dragon. I just kind of had my head in this guy's mind for so long, I was ready to move away from it a little bit.
Yeah.
So I just finished it this week.
G in your liver?
With a nice Chianti, some fava beans? No.
I can't even do it.
Did I send you that picture? I sent that picture to Melissa and maybe somebody else. I took a picture of
you. Posted it on Facebook.
I did post it on Facebook.
Yeah. About Mr. Lecter talking about how he's preparing, was it liver or?
Brains.
Brains.
Paul Krendler's brains. Spoiler alert.
It sounded delicious.
I know.
Like, so if that wasn't human brains, I would eat that.
People eat monkey brains. People, you know what? I was.
And then they get AIDS.
No, they don't. Do they really? That'd be terrible. Do you know what head cheese is?
It's two words that should never be used in the same sentence together.
Ah, so that means no. Now I was at Smith's and I saw that they had some head cheese in their little discount section of the deli, and I'm like, whoa, this is weird. These head cheese, from what I understand, based on the movie Texas Chainsaw Massacre, it's a cow brain boiled.
Hmm.
And it gets like a gelatin around it.
Yeah.
And that's what head cheese is. And people love that shit.
I am.
While you eat your chicken.
I don't think I would want to eat that head cheese.
It sounds gross. I mean, but when I saw it at Smith's, I was like, this can't be the same thing. Because it just looked kind of like chunks of ham.
Yeah.
Like you put, you know, with your breakfast. Like a whole ham opposed to like a sliced ham or something.
Right.
I think this is done. I know there's still shit on here, but I think I'm done with this.
Oh, that's like, you only eat half of that.
I know. There's still all this meat.
It's a good save for later.
So I'm just gonna toss it.
Oh, don't toss it.
I give it to the cats.
Take your man card.
I hate the gross meat on the bottom of the fucking...
It's just a little oily.
Chicken and turkey. I hate the bottom meat. I hate dealing with it. Turkey is a little bit better because it isn't as oily as this. This has been sitting in its own fucking
juices.
Yeah, it's been stewing in its own juices over at Walmart for the last 2 hours. 3 hours, probably, by this point. But yeah, no, I had my head in those Hannibal movies, and looking at this, is because it's all about, like, food and eating people and such. And I recently realized that cannibalism is probably one of the scariest things to me.
Oh, yeah?
Like, maybe not scary, but, like,
one of those
disturbing.
Terrifying.
Yeah, just disturbing on every level. Like,
yeah.
That's probably why I find, like, movies like Texas Chainsaw Massacre, like, the more scary ones.
Yeah.
It's because those are all about fucking
People eating people. I should do a Donner Party horror movie.
You know what? I recently read that no one ate anybody on that.
Yeah? There's a play. I forget the name of the play. But it's about the guy, one guy who survived, him being on trial.
Are you talking about Alpha Packer?
I have no idea.
Well, you probably are. I'll send this away with you when you leave today. And that wasn't the Donner Party. It was in Utah. Matt Stone and Trey Parker, the South Park guys, they made Cannibal the musical about Alpha Packer.
Okay.
Who took a group of, like, Mormons, and they're trying to go to, I think they went from Colorado to, they're trying to go to Utah or something like that.
Oh, okay.
And he was the only one that wound up there alive.
Okay.
And they said that he ate them. But there was a weird stipulation that, like, the law passed at a certain time.
Yeah.
To where it wasn't illegal to do that.
So you can actually eat people and get away with it.
Hello.
So Matt's at the door getting a FedEx package right now.
Thank you.
I'm gonna eat my chicken. And he's back. What'd you get?
A package.
From Amazon.
It's probably from Hannibal Lecter.
Yeah.
What were you saying while I was gone?
I was giving a play-by-play.
But yeah, no, so Cannibal the Musical is the thing.
Right.
It's probably... Oh, that's right. Alright, so... From least exciting to most exciting.
Matchstick Men. Alright.
A Ridley Scott film. I used to have this, but I had it on the stupid Snap Warner Brothers.
Oh, right.
So I traded in all the ones that I could rebuy in a regular case when I was in Colorado. But I haven't bought them all back yet.
Yeah.
So I got Magic Man because it was like a couple bucks.
Is that Mark Wahlberg?
It's Sam Rockwell.
Sam Rockwell. Sam Rockwell's best movie?
There's no way that I can choose one.
Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles?
Oh, come on.
The Angela Lansbury, George Hearn, Sweeney Todd. The film stage production. Very nice.
And then this I also used to have in a Snap case that I traded in.
Yeah.
So now these are both in nice cases that match everything else.
That's a good version of that. George Hearn is so good in that.
You didn't take advanced drama, did you? Or beginning drama?
I didn't take any high school.
Yeah, Matthew showed this in beginning drama. Yeah. And I was like, whoa.
I saw that in my college acting classes.
Okay, you saw in college. Okay. And then when it came out, I bought it the first day it came out on DVD.
Yeah.
And then I bought it again today.
Nice.
Waste of money. The first time around. And then this one.
Evil Dead 2, Sam Raimi's only good franchise.
Oh, you're saying Spider-Man's not very good?
First one.
Second one is supposed to be good. Haven't we talked about this? We're not talking about this. But this is on Blu-ray. I got it on Blu-ray because I've got the Necronomicon version that's falling apart.
Oh, yeah.
Just from age. It's not falling apart from wear and tear. It's just...
starting to...
like, dry out.
Decay
or,
like a dead body.
Like a fucking flesh-covered tome. All right, and now here's the best one.
Best one of the four.
Damn it.
And it is... The Thing. John
nice
Carpenter's The Thing.
Steelbook Blu-ray.
Nice. No it's, insert.
No insert, and it's a import.
Is it the right Region.
I did. I made sure to check. It's I can watch Region A and Region C.
Just no B's.
No B's because that is European. And apparently Japanese and American are the same, but yet mm-hmm. they're distinguished by a different letter.
Yeah, they're probably all shot in PAL, whereas... or NTSC. Whereas Europe is probably shot on PAL. Video format style.
So if we were to record a movie on PAL, we wouldn't be able to watch it?
I'd have to look into it, but I don't think so.
Well, I mean, the best that we can do to look into it is just record something, put it on a DVD and pop it into the thing.
Yeah.
I could have sworn I looked it up, but I'm not seeing it on here. So if this doesn't fucking play, like fucking... Saw, the last one.
Saw, Final Chapter.
Final Chapter, that's it. Those were the words I was looking for. If it doesn't fucking play...
Then you got a really awesome steelbook.
Yeah, and I'll just put my other DVD or my other Blu-ray in there. Because that's what I did. I went and bought fucking Saw again.
Yeah.
And then I just put the two together.
Yeah. Right there. You have the good case and then the good disc.
Yeah, well, I just used the slip cover... Because so the slip cover is the same as the case, and then this one's clear so that it's got the Saw
right
artwork on the disc that's going through.
And very nice.
The tickets for when I went and saw it. But we bought tickets for Paranormal Activity 2,
mm-hmm.
and then snuck in the Saw 3D with our glasses so that we didn't pay like $50 a ticket or you know.
No,
not
yeah.
literally $50, but it's like, what, $13 to see a movie in 3D? And I think it was on the big XP screen.
Yeah.
But yeah, so this was the big ticket right here, was getting the thing on Steelbook. And it's pretty fucking sick, dude.
Nice.
The only problem with it? What's the problem with it?
It's sideways. So if it weren't sideways...
it would be... that much cooler, but so it's all sideways on the back too.
That's for when you have it out and looking at it. As long as the spine is good.
Spine's fine. Spine's fine. The number one horror movie, in my opinion, is The Thing. So I've wanted a good, decent edition of it. Not to say that the last one wasn't, but I think it was just a regular, like, here it is on Blu-ray.
Bare bones Blu-ray.
Not bare bones, just the same stuff the other, like, the DVD had.
Right.
I'm pretty sure this is the same disc, only foreign, but, like, it's got a cool steelbook case. and Evil Dead 2, like I said, the other one was falling apart.
Yeah.
And this one I could loan out to people. I don't want to loan out that one if it's fucking dying on me.
Yeah.
And it's also signed by Bruce Campbell.
Oh, nice.
When he was in town like 5 years ago. 8 years ago. God, it was 8 years ago.
I used to have a signed Bruce Campbell poster from Briscoe County Jr.
From, you're telling me
from
that.
Like 20 years ago.
20 years ago?
Around that time.
You're only like 19 years old, Greg.
And, dropped the guacamole on the DVD cases. Oh, no.
Thanks a lot, Greg.
But, I was, you know, under 10 years old and I didn't know how to take care of stuff or be a collector.
No.
So.
I don't like where this story's going.
I have no idea where my Bruce Campbell signature is from Briscoe County Jr. So what you need is Evil Dead Bruce Campbell signature, Briscoe County signature, and a Burn Notice signature.
Burn Notice, that's the TV show he's on?
Yeah.
Do you watch that show?
I've seen it a few times, yeah.
And is he, what, like he's like an FBI, CIA, ex?
He's like an ex-CIA guy, operative, like technician operative kind of guy that helps out the main character. He can put together explosions. Really nicely. good show.
What is that? What did I text you yesterday? Them Winchester boys?
Them Winchester boys.
I
love Supernatural.
Because I was watching Friday the 13th. And you still insist that it was Texas Chainsaw. I don't know why.
The original time I thought he was in Texas Chainsaw, because...
So you haven't seen either, then?
I've seen the Texas Chainsaw because of...
Jordana Brewster. Then how does that get crossed with Jared Padalecki?
Because researching it, and you see, oh, this guy that I like that's recent is in this recent remake, and recently watched this recent remake with this recent actress.
Yeah, I, because I was reading about something Friday the 13th in my Horror Hound magazine, which I forgot to bring home.
It's in your locker at work?
It's on my cart at work.
Yeah.
I was like, didn't Patrick tell me Paramount was the studio head he was talking to? And I was like, I texted that to him. He's like, we should make a fucking Friday the 13th. He's like, no, it's 20th century, but fucking write it anyways, dude. It'll probably be the easiest thing you ever write. So I was like, okay. So I was watching the remake yesterday for research to kind of write a sequel to that.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not the best idea, but I like Derek Mears. You know, I've got the signed here, I believe. The signed Derek Mears picture.
Right.
When we met him. So I was like, okay, I'll write it for him as the Jason.
Mm-hmm.
And just let it sit there. It may never ever get made, but...
Well, shoot, I can pull off a weird-looking Jason.
You can pull off one?
Yeah, I just need to bulk up a bit.
Get taller. I want, like...
You want, like...
6'5", 7 feet. Yeah. Let's see how tall Derek Mears is.
6'5", and, like, 250 pounds.
300.
300 pounds.
Let's see if we get Derek Mears' stats on here.
Basically Kane.
Basically Kane. Just put a fuck... That's funny. So he was born in 72, so that means he's like, what, 40?
Old, yeah.
41? He looks kind of old in that picture, too.
It's the mustache. He's got a...
It is the mustache.
He's got a molestache in his profile picture.
He looks kind of like... Who does he look like?
Someone.
They're not giving me any trivia here. 6'5". And he is divorced. Trademark towering height. Performs regularly with improv comedy group Comedy Sports.
Huh.
He owns a cat. Derek Mears, everybody. If I had my phone.
Actually, I think our bulkiest person is Dakota, so.
Well, we need a monster in this new movie, and he said use his roommate who's 6'5".
Oh, that'd be good.
Throw a fucking monster costume. I mean, we gotta make a monster costume, something.
That's like the guy who played the engineer in Prometheus. I know it's your favorite movie ever made.
I like Prometheus.
Thank you. So many people hate it, and I love it.
Mike's the one that's a dick about it. He didn't even watch it.
I love the movie, but the actor who plays the engineer, he's like 7 feet tall in real life.
Instead of just being like, did he play everybody in that movie?
All the engineers.
He played all of them?
Yeah. I'm pretty sure.
Because, I mean, they could digitally do that because they do it with fucking Gandalf. Mm-hmm. But, like, why not get an actual tall guy to do that? Or did they make him look bigger?
I do not know. Who, Gandalf?
No.
Oh.
The engineer.
Oh, the engineer.
Because...
Well, I mean, he's supposed to be... The engineer is supposed to be, like, a foot or two taller than humans.
Yeah, yeah.
But...
Well, what's her face has got to be fucking tiny.
Naomi Rapace?
Yeah. Noomi Rapace. She's got to be fucking tiny.
But, the actual actor who played the engineer is actually really quite tall. He plays the demon in Don't Move.
Right.
Yeah.
We've discussed this.
Don't Move is pretty awesome. Bloody Cuts out of the UK.
Here he goes fucking pimping something that we're not getting any money for. Yeah, see, Noomi Rapace is 5'4".
And a quarter.
Let's see. Let's bring up that dude.
5'4", that's not too short. That's pretty average woman height.
Yeah, what, Olivia's like, what, 5? Or is Olivia 5'4"?
She's probably 5'1".
She's pretty tiny. Let's see here. Is there any trivia on this guy? I didn't click on. Is it going to be engineer?
Most likely.
Or do you know his name?
I don't know his name, but full cast.
Nah, I didn't see this fucking dickhead.
Last
right here.
Engineer. Ian White. That's him.
Oh, so there's a couple different engineers.
Yes, it's Ian White.
Hold on. Oh, that's right. Patrick Wilson was in that movie. He played her dad in the fucking little video. Oh, shit, dude. So weird. So random that he's in the fucking movie in a huge, like a little tiny cameo.
Yeah. So Ian White. How tall is Ian White?
Oh, look at this. Melissa, if you're listening, he's got the same birthday as you.
September 17th.
And Greg, your birthday is tomorrow.
My birthday is tomorrow.
No one's going to listen to this for another 3 weeks, so.
He's been quite a few people in big movies.
Are these stunts? No, these are actors.
Let's see, Game of Thrones. He's a couple different people in Gregor. Game of Thrones.
Well, it looks like he's mostly Gregor.
Mm-hmm.
Clegan.
Don't move there, he's the demon. Clash of the Titans, he's Sheik Salimane.
Suleiman?
Suleiman, however you say that.
I don't remember who that is. He's in Solomon Kane. He's in Dragon Ball Evolution as Uzaru. Who the fuck is Uzaru? Stupid.
He's played a predator.
I wonder if he was the main predator in this. In oh, no, I didn't see this one.
Yeah. He's one of the main predators in Alien vs. Predator.
Scar. Is that the main predator?
I think
so. Do you have those movies?
I think I have AVP. I don't have Requiem.
I was thinking about getting those a little while back.
No, I've got the Aliens and I've got the Predators, but I don't have AVP.
Never mind then. Is that him?
Mm-hmm.
7-1.
7-1. He has massive.
Oh, he's from New Jersey.
Joyzy.
Henry Hudson High School. That's where fucking like Kevin Smith and all them went.
Oh, cool.
Because, you know, I'm a fucking religiously listen to all of his podcasts that he's on, and they always mention Henry Hudson, so that's really fucking cool.
It's a small world.
It is a super fucking small world.
After all.
What's this? Had a hard time dealing with the weight of the Predator makeup when he went in for the first costume test for ABP. Therefore, he devised a method of building muscle where he would stuff a vest with rocks and jog regularly for a few weeks.
Wow.
When he went back in for the second costume test, he was stronger and able to carry the weight of the outfit better.
Wow.
So what is that? He would, like, he would put on a vest.
He'd basically have a mock costume that he built himself with all the weight of it, and then start
work out in it.
Okay, yeah.
Get used to the weight, okay. And then Derek Mears played the old Predator.
The original?
The original Predator in Predators.
What an ugly mother.
Well, no, he wasn't that one.
No.
That was... But in Predators.
Oh, okay.
The new one. He played the original-looking Predator that they have strapped up to the pyre or whatever.
Right, right.
Classic Predator is what he's called. Now, the original Predator was...
And that is how you finish a whole chicken.
Yeah, Greg fucking put me to shame. Fuck you, Greg.
That was delicious. I've got a big pile of bones sitting right here, and Matt has half a chicken sitting in his.
I'm going to give it to the cats.
I probably won't eat again today, but...
Alright, let's see here. So yeah, so Derek Mears was the classic Predator in Predators. He played Jason in the remake of Friday the 13th. He was in Hills Have Eyes 2, which wasn't a very good movie.
I still haven't seen any of the Hills Have Eyes. The original or the remakes.
Being such a big Wes Craven fan that you are, you haven't seen that?
It's surprising, I know.
Wes Crazens? Hills Have Eyes are good.
Because there's a trailer for it at the beginning of Sunshine, which was one of my top three favorite movies of all time.
For the which is kind of like a horror movie.
It is. It starts off being a space movie, which was my favorite genre of all time. And then it turns into sci-fi. And then it turns into a horror movie.
It turns into a slasher movie, which you hate.
Although I enjoy good slashers.
You can say that about any movie. I enjoy good comedies. I enjoy good action movies. Don't give me your bullshit, dude. It was The Werewolf and Cursed, apparently. That was a pretty big wolf, too.
That was.
For a shitty movie. He was Mosh Tendrils in Men in Black 2. He had a whole set of pictures when we met him.
Yeah.
So he had, like, a photo of him from Men in Black 2, Predator shit, and everything for him to sign. And we got the Jason one.
I really didn't care for Men in Black 2.
It's got Rosario Dawson in it.
I like Rosario Dawson. Which is a plus. It's definitely a plus.
Did you see 3?
I have not seen number 3.
I thought 3 was the best.
Yeah. I really love how 1, because it was made in the 90s, correct?
Like 95.
Yeah, and I love the style of the first one and the tone and themes of it.
That's the mid-90s for you, dude.
Yeah, I love that. I love that style from that era. And
Blade is also a lot like that.
Yes. And then The Matrix as well.
And then the sequels come along, and they sacrifice story for, you know, fluff. Like, yeah, whether it's mostly action or mostly comedy or whatever.
Right. Which a lot of the action scenes in Men in Black 2 were very comedic as well.
Well, you got Johnny Knoxville in there.
Johnny Knoxville. Like, when the head guy at Men in Black, he starts using Zed. Shock. Zed, when he starts fighting back and he's jumping around everywhere like Yoda. Like freaking Yoda in Star Wars. And I'm like, ah, no. Yoda does that. You don't do that. But, yeah, I really love how it's almost darker, the first one.
Yeah, you get that a lot, too, also with, like, Blade. The first Blade's a lot darker. Have you seen both Blades?
Yes, I have.
Have you seen the third one?
I have. I think I saw the third one in theaters, actually.
I haven't seen the third one.
It's got Jessica Biel in it.
Jessica Biel and Ryan Reynolds. I'm not a big fan of Jessica Biel. I don't think she's all that great.
She usually wears very nice-looking pants.
Well, beyond that, I don't find Jessica Biel to be all that. She's not my type.
She's got a slamming body.
Which, you see, this is what I said about fucking Man in Black 2 with Rosario Dawson. Mm-hmm. I like Rosario Dawson. But yeah, like, the first Blade, it's darker. It's mm-hmm. got a darker vision to it. And then mm-hmm. the second one, it's like all...
Which
Roddy.
I like the second one better for the Blades.
Oh, I do too.
Yeah.
But it does definitely sacrifice plot and story to throw in as much action as possible.
Yeah. But they did it right.
They did do it right. Well, that was directed by Guillermo del Toro, and who is an amazing director.
Yeah.
In and of himself. Like Pan's Labyrinth. You're a big Pan's Labyrinth fan.
I am a big Pan's Labyrinth fan. I recently got it back from someone who was borrowing it for ages.
Really? I thought I saw it, like, when we were filming, when we were going over to your place.
Yeah. Recently, as in... This year. Recently, but,
opposed to...
But one of my buddies, he was playing on piano one time at work, because I worked at a theater at the time. And he's playing something that he had made up himself, a little lullaby that he had made up himself. And I was like, hey, that's Pan's Labyrinth. And he's like, what are you talking about? This is something I made up myself. And he's like, oh, well, I got Pan's Labyrinth. You got to watch this now. And then... He finally watched it after having it for like 3 or 4 months.
Very similar song.
And he's like, yeah, that sounds a lot like the song I made up. So basically the theme of Pan's Labyrinth.
Accidentally created mm-hmm. it himself.
Mm-hmm.
That happens.
Which, when I hear them side by side, they're quite a bit different. But they have the same kind of imagery.
Like the basic general kind of...
Yeah. Which is almost a little bit horror, bit like Pale Man in Pan's Labyrinth. That's very much horror movie right there.
That whole movie is scary, dude.
Yeah.
I mean, just the, like... It's like
even Pan himself is scary, I think.
Well, beyond that, before you even get into the, like, the bulk of what it's about, like, it's during, like, the Mexican Revolution?
Spanish
Revolution?
Spanish Civil War. It's set in Spain.
So, like... Being an American, it kind of feels like World War II.
Yeah.
So, like, just to give you that idea, you know, a little girl kind of like in a Holocaust-type situation where people are getting killed in the middle of this battle.
When was Spanish Civil War?
Well, let's look it up, Rick.
All right. A little history lesson.
It's got to be in the 1800s, right?
Oh, no. They had car automobiles, so.
They did, right.
I'm thinking 1950s.
Oh, shit, dude. It went for almost 100 years.
Wow, 1853 to 1939.
So they caught it at the end of the Spanish Civil War in that movie. Holy shit, man. Wow.
See if you can find out the setting year for Pan's Labyrinth. That way we can know for sure. It's 1939.
I really like the bad guy in that movie. The
the
general guy.
He is very, very well, good acting and good character, too.
It takes place in 1944, 5 years after the Spanish Civil War.
5 years after, okay. So it's still rebels.
Still rebels, still very much probably a military presence.
Yeah, still kind of a military state.
Wow.
1944.
Interesting stuff.
1944, that's when Hitler died, right?
1944 was when there was D-Day, and then the World War II ended in 1945.
Right.
So it was the beginning of the end.
Americans come in, send in the cavalry.
Let's not wave our flag too high around here.
No, not anymore. Load up that statement.
World War II timeline, 39 to 45. I'm pretty sure, and D-Day was June 6th, I believe. I've got the book somewhere over there. Cornelius Ryan. Right there.
Nice.
Hitler. Let's put that in. He died.
Adolf Elizabeth Hitler.
Does it really say that?
45.
Yeah, April 30th, 1945. It doesn't say Elizabeth anywhere, does it? It doesn't look like he has a middle name.
That's from the producers, of course.
Adolf Elizabeth Hitler.
Oh, is it?
Elizabeth?
Elizabeth.
Which version of the producers? The musical?
The musical, Matthew Broderick and Nathan Lane version, where Will Ferrell is playing the Nazi.
Well, see, it's funny because in the original movie, they get like this hippie guy to play Hitler, and he plays it like a hippie.
Mm-hmm.
But then in the musical, he plays it for serious.
Right.
But he's an idiot, so it comes off as funny. So like, I didn't understand that choice that he made to change it like that.
Mm.
Because everyone was laughing at him that he was like a hippie, and he was all like...
See, I've never seen the original, so... Alright, we can move Adolf Hitler off the screen. I mean, it is horror.
It's scary stuff. Scary stuff right there.
That was a scary dude for sure.
Alright, so... Do you have any... scary moments in real life? Any scary stories that you've experienced?
I had a dream. I had a night terror once. I've only had one night terror. And it's interesting. Talking to some friends of mine, they talk about their scary dreams, their nightmares, and their night terrors. And I've only ever had the one night terror. I've had, of course, nightmares before.
Well, what's your definition of night terror?
A night terror was, for me, is when you... it's like in... what's the movie... Close Encounters of the Fourth Kind.
Fourth Kind?
Where they describe a night terror as waking up and having the feeling of being paralyzed. Where you can't move.
Okay.
So, like, your brain wakes up, but your body doesn't. So you can't move. That's how this scientifically explains it, is you're conscious, but your body's still asleep.
Mm-hmm.
So, and it was really kind of terrifying. Hence, night terror. But the dream I had leading up to it was really freaking scary, because I was walking through this dark house, and it's kind of an older style house. It's like your grandmother's house.
Like your classic old dark scary house type situation?
It was like a normal grandmother's house, but at night. No lights are on.
Okay.
And I was walking through, and I get to this door, and I open the door, and it's super dark room inside, and there's some classic old people furniture in there.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
The high back chairs and that kind of stuff. And I walk in, and I turn the corner on the chair, one of the high back chairs, It's kind of a wingback chair in a way, kind of like Matthews' old chair that he had on stage, only it was rose colored.
Sorry,
I got a piece of shit caught in the back of my throat.
And as I turn the corner on the chair, there's this creature sitting in it. And I can remember it vividly. It was this little furry creature, only it kind of looked like Alf in a way, because it had a long snout. It was like Alf, his scary cousin, kind of evil twin kind of thing. He had massive claws, long snout with really sharp teeth. I'm sitting there looking at him, and all of a sudden he opens his eyes and he jumps onto my chest. And right as he bites down, that's when I wake up. But my body's, and I'm just sitting there, and it feels like this huge weight is just sitting on top of my chest as I'm awake in bed. I'm like, holy crap, what is going on right now? Is there an actual demon inside my room right now? And it really, really freaked me out.
Write that down, Greg.
But that was my one night terror. But this, just the, like, this dream itself was scary, and it was like, okay, this is a normal scary dream. It wasn't necessarily a nightmare, and but until that moment where he jumps and attacks onto my chest, and then the scariest part about it was waking up, feeling and having the sense of this
experience right there,
having this heavy weight on top of me, not being able to move, was very terrifying. And that was what, like 8 years ago or something like that.
Semi-recently.
Which would, that would probably make a good movie.
The creature, definitely. And then just like,
I tried drawing it afterwards and I didn't get it quite right. But
really?
Yeah.
That's cool.
I still have the image of it in my head still.
Do you have any favorite like scary stories or anything? Shit that you read?
Growing up, I loved reading Goosebumps.
Of course.
Goosebumps were amazing. I'm going to have to borrow all of those.
You can knock them out in like 30 minutes, dude. They're so super fast to read.
Although my absolute most favorite Goosebumps story of all time was How I Learned to Fly, which is not a horror at all.
I don't have that one.
How I Learned to Fly is so good. And it's not really a scary story at all.
He just learns to fly?
Yeah. And flying has always been my number one fantasy.
I think everyone's, dude. I think everyone wants, I want to know what it feels like to fly.
Yeah. But the TV show of Goosebumps, when I was a kid, of course they were scary, but the scariest one, that it was like an hour-long special, and it was at night instead of in the morning. It's like Goosebumps, hour-long special at night. I was like, oh, can we stay up to watch it?
The Haunted Mask?
It was Werewolf of something, something Swamp, or something like that. And I've never remembered the title of it.
The Werewolf of Fever Swamp.
Werewolf of Fever Swamp. The hour-long special they did with that on TV scared the bejesus out of me. I was like 8 years old, and it freaking terrified me when the werewolf is
those
sitting
were
there.
Good fucking shit, dude. Like,
yeah.
You were younger than me when that came on. So like, even me in like, I guess, fifth, sixth grade, I love those. You had to have been in like
third or fourth
grade.
Fourth into your year. But, yeah, when there's, I remember the moment where the werewolf is just clawing on the shack in Fever Swamp, and I was like, I can't watch this, I'm too scared. Shoot, Jurassic Park, when the first time I watched Jurassic Park, when it first came out on video, which was
when
what,
the raptors are going 94? Through the kitchen is what you're going to talk about?
Yeah, I could not sit through the kitchen with the raptors. It scared, I just like, this is too scary for me as a child, you know? And it was a really good moment. And they finally put Goosebumps up on Netflix.
Oh, shit. Yes, they did.
Which I watched a couple of them.
Did you really? Which one did you watch? Did you watch the Werewolf Fever Swamp?
I watched the Phantom one, Phantom of the Auditorium.
It's the janitor.
The Girl Who Cried Monster.
That was the first one. I mean, they did the Haunted Mask as a special, and then when they did it as a TV show, The Girl Who Cried Monster was the first one. That was my first book of Goosebumps.
Yeah. And watching them now, I'm just like, wow, these are...
They're dated.
They're a little bit dated, and they're definitely geared toward a younger audience. But the aspects, the horror aspects of them are still there, and you can still see why it's scary.
Totally, dude. I mean, like,
even if you get lost in the cheese in the camp. Oh, they got more seasons. The first time I saw this on here, they only had the one season.
Yeah, they've got four seasons on here. I'm not seeing Werewolf Skin, something different. And if you're saying if it's a special, because I'm not seeing Haunted Mask on here either, and that was the first one. Yeah, they don't got those on here.
Mm.
So yeah, if it was a special,
YouTube's
Werewolf of Fever Swamp. Yeah, that's not gonna be on there. I did see something else on here of Goosebumps. One Day at Horrorland. Oh, those are all unavailable.
Oh. How to Eat Fried Worms.
Eat Fried Worms.
Was that a Goosebumps?
Yeah. Right? Oh, no. Go Eat Worms, I think. Eat Worms.
How to Eat Fried Worms is something different, yeah.
No, that was like a comedic book, wasn't it? Like
a children's book, yeah. That was the first time I heard of horseradish sauce.
He puts horseradish on the...
Yeah. On the worms.
Is it horsey?
Horsey sauce.
Horse-er radish?
There's Worcestershire sauce.
Oh, you know what? They put the words together.
Yeah.
So it's horseradish.
Horseradish.
So, but you read it.
Horsey.
You could see horse-er on there.
Oh, okay.
And then you realize that you're adding the R to it. I think that's what it is.
Here we go. Werewolf of Fever Swamp.
43 minutes. But we're not going to sit here and watch this.
I'm too scared. But
so what do you think of the new setup here?
I love it. I like that the tracks are on the bottom. And I like that all the stuff is on top. I think it falls in line with all the other editors that I've seen.
See, it doesn't.
We're talking about Sony Vegas 11.
Sony Vegas 11. See, it doesn't have the sweep on there with the color.
It kind of does.
The other one did. Yeah, you can see there's a thing, but the other ones, it was green. It was red.
Oh, right.
It was blue.
Right.
But these don't have anything.
Which, when you throw them onto the video, you got the controls in there, so.
Yeah, and going through these, I didn't see any new things.
So basically, they put the timelines from the top to the bottom and moved all of the Explorer stuff and the preview to the top. So they basically just
swapped it.
Flipped it.
And it's like a silverish color. I mean,
but we did go from 6 to 11, so there's probably some bug fixes and some...
there's gotta be.
Yeah. I wonder if we can add more tracks and...
more beyond this, what they gave us.
And you said there was an audio editor?
There's an audio editor. When I went into it, I didn't really like it because, here I've got three tracks that I can use.
Right.
With the addition of more, at least one more.
So we had more than that?
There's one more. There's another one. We can keep going, dude!
Awesome. Awesome. So we're not limited to four audio tracks.
Not at all. I can't take them out yet. But yeah, no, I went into it, and the way it goes is it'll bring up a thing, and you'll record on it,
mm-hmm.
and then once you're done recording, it'll pop it up. And, I didn't really explore it, but it made me feel like I couldn't really,
edit
put multiple tracks. Yeah,
okay.
It didn't seem like it would bring up multiple tracks, instead it just looked like it brought up
another
separate window.
So you can edit the one
window.
Track?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, and there were sound editors on there, so you can do, an echoing voice
cool.
and things like that.
So you can manipulate the sound of the track. So that's good.
So I think it's more for here's this,
manipulate
it off of this,
the track.
And put it over there.
Yeah, so you're manipulating the track, not creating tracks.
And then you just bring it back over.
Okay.
So that's what, I mean, without exploring it, I was just like, no, I'm going to keep potting on this for the time being.
Right.
But it did mention the audio editor in the review of it, and he said, perfect for podcasters.
Yeah.
But I'm not using it, so, for that purpose.
Once
we
learn it.
Exactly. Once we learn it, and if I like it there, then sure.
These refried beans are stiff.
They are. We should have heated them up.
Head them
up.
It's delicious, though.
All right. So So those are your scary stories. Nothing else you used to read. I was actually, this book right here, I was able to, like, I don't want to go over what me and Dakota talked about, but Dakota talked about this, and I was like, I think I have that book. And he was like, oh, shit! You know? I blew Dakota's mind a couple times yesterday.
Nice.
And then we started to read it for this other thing that I want to do.
Yeah.
And it was kind of disillusioning for him, because it wasn't...
wasn't as scary.
It wasn't that it wasn't as scary, but it wasn't how he remembered it.
Right. Yeah, mostly the only really scary books I read were Goosebumps.
No, like Edgar Allan Poe's, Lovecraft.
Yeah, I never read those as a child.
Never read any Edgar Allan Poe?
No.
I basically read have to be as a child, but like as an adult, is there like a, you know, do you have a favorite Stephen King? Do you even read Stephen King?
I've never read a single Stephen King story.
And yet here I have read like all of them.
Yeah.
You know, Edgar Allan Poe, Dean Koontz.
My reading, I mostly stick to young adult adventure fantasy.
Yes, you do. You're a sci-fi fantasy guy. Sci-fi fantasy. How about like...
And I love reading the young adult genre.
There's nothing, no horror-centric. Twilight? You're a Twilight guy.
I did like Twilight. There's no really scary moments in Twilight.
But it's about vampires.
The Maze Runner trilogy.
Scary?
There are some scary aspects.
Horror elements?
There are some horror elements. There's a...
Is there a Minotaur in there?
They call them Grievers. And it's this, like, biomechanical machine that terrorizes and kills the kids when they're on the maze.
Oh, shit.
You probably like the Maze Runner trilogy. And there's zombies in that. And, well, they call them... They have the... oh, what is it called? Not the heat wave or... I forget what the disease is called, but basically turns people into zombies. It's this James Dashner's version of zombies, basically.
Were you going to say the author's version? Since I brought it up, you were able to read the author's...
The Scorch. Name. They call it The Scorch.
The Scorch. Yeah. Where'd you see that at?
I just remembered it.
Oh, okay.
But those are three really, really good books.
Any horror comics or anything? I know you like to read comics.
I mostly stick to the superheroes in comics. I love reading Batman.
There's a really good scary Batman Scarecrow issue.
Which I think I have that, but I haven't read it yet.
It's a Joker's Asylum.
I have not read that one.
It's a Joker's Asylum, and it's his spotlight on Scarecrow, and it's like a haunted house story, so there's like a bunch of kids going to this house.
I have read the one, I think it's called Arkham Asylum.
Serious House on Serious Earth, the Grant Morrison, that's kind of like, it's like a weird painting.
Every panel is really, really weird. It's the Batman in it has the curls on his shoulders, and that one was really good.
That one's pretty scary too.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was written by Grant Morrison, and it was
that one right there.
Dave McKeon did the artwork on that one. Is that the exact one you have?
That's the exact one.
With the does it have an intro in there? A new introduction or something? This is the 15th anniversary. Fuck, dude.
That's the cover of that
one. I mean, are there any particularly scary villains? We can talk about that.
My favorite villain of all time, and I think in my mind they're really scary, is the Borg from Star Trek.
Borg is scary. The Borg are you can't fight them.
Yeah, the Borg are just my favorite. I think they're the best villain of all time.
I don't know about best, but like amongst the best,
they're definitely top five villains, and not being able to, they just keep coming at you, and
they're adaptive.
Everything you throw at them, they adapt to it, and you're basically screwed unless you're Captain Picard.
And he got fucked over too.
But I actually have a Borg origin type story that I've been working on as well.
Really?
Yeah.
Interesting. Is there not an origin out there?
There's a couple different origins in the Star Trek canon and lore, but there's nothing. There's no specific stories. They're like that I've read or seen.
From what I understand, and tell me if I'm wrong, you might not even know. But
so mine is kind of my own origin to the Borg.
Did the Borg create themselves? Because
it's really kind of unknown.
Because in First Contact, they go back in time.
Yeah.
To stop Zefram Cochrane and destroy the Earth.
Yeah. And send, because they're still in the Delta Quadrant. and they try to send a signal back in time to the Delta Quadrant so they can get to Earth faster.
And don't, like, a couple of them, I think some of them get stuck back there.
Yeah.
And the Enterprise crew runs into them.
Yeah, the Star Trek Enterprise series, they run into them. They were frozen in the North Pole, I believe.
Yeah. Have you seen all those Enterprise episodes?
I've not seen all the Enterprise episodes.
But you've seen that one?
Yeah.
Crazy, man.
The Borg are fascinating to me.
I agree. All right, let's talk about... You watch a lot of TV.
Yeah.
Halloween episodes.
Halloween episodes, okay.
Simpsons, of course, has the Treehouse of Horrors every year. The
Treehouses of Horror are really good. I like the Simpsons Raven.
Yeah, yeah. That's the first episode of Treehouse of Horrors.
The alien, whenever they have the one-eyed aliens on there, they're always good.
Kang and Kodos, who are named after Star Trek Klingons.
Yeah.
The one guy did the voice for Mr. Freeze, who played Kang, I believe.
Mm. There was...
He just died.
I think it was a Halloween episode for X-Files, where it's these three...
Vampires?
They're kind of like genetically... retarded in a way. It opens up with these three brothers. Their mom has a kid, and the kids
they're fucking inbred monsters.
Inbred monsters, and that episode.
No, that's the scariest fucking thing in the world.
Yeah,
dude.
That episode was really scary because right at the beginning, the chick's hiding under the bed, and she thinks it's fine. And then all of a sudden, of course, they find her under the bed, pull her out, and beat her with the baseball bat to death.
It's
and,
because what they've been doing... Now, this is really, really cool. This is cool. I'll talk about this. We'll talk about this episode in length. When I first got into X-Files back in, like, 95, 96 or whatever, FX did a whole marathon. And that was voted the number one most popular episode at the time. I don't know about now.
Scary episode.
And it was called Home. Home was the name of the episode, and so, like, it begins with the birth of a child.
Yeah.
And for some reason, like, they can tell the child's not going to live or something. They just fucking bury it in the fucking baseball field where the kids are playing.
Yeah, right at home plate.
Yeah, right at home plate, and the kid fucking is digging his foot in, and the blood comes up.
Oh, disturbing.
It is super fucking disturbing, and so the FBI is called in.
Yeah.
And... It starts not the couple, it's like the sheriff and his wife or something like that. And so
three guys are driving that convertible.
Like an old fucking Chevy, and every time they turn it on it plays Johnny Mathis's Somewhere My Love.
Yeah.
And it becomes like this haunting tune.
Yeah.
Because they go out there and they just beat them with a baseball bat with like clubs.
Mm-hmm.
And they keep beating people with clubs and shit, and they're almost impossible to kill. They're like these inhuman monsters with retard strength, as they say in the movies. Not to offend anybody, but that's what they go with. Like, Jason's got retard strength.
Yeah.
But it really is. It's super fucked. And the house is trapped.
Just a side note. Christopher Titus, the comedian, has a really awesome, spiel on the word retard.
Does he really?
Really worth watching.
Is it a, stand-up?
Yeah.
It's on YouTube. It's on Netflix, too. I've seen his Netflix,
I'm not sure if it might be in a Netflix special, but it's definitely on YouTube.
I liked him. I used to watch his show. I never watched his stand-up, but I saw that they have him on
Netflix. Yeah, he has a really good explanation of the way he thinks of retard, and I thought it was awesome. But anyways, these guys have the, quote, retard strength.
They do, and, like, their house is all fucked. You know, and Mulder's getting into the whole, like, it's like Mayberry.
Yeah.
You know, and then suddenly, like, there's these guys killing people, and it's, maybe not so much anymore. And the house is booby-trapped, and they're barely able to kill them.
Yeah.
And they've got, like, their mom is, like, missing all of her arms, all of her limbs.
Yeah.
She's just on, like, a rolly thing.
Yeah.
And they've just been having sex with her, keeping the line alive. So they've got to, like... get another girl or something.
Yeah.
But the one lives, takes the mom, and they take off, and that's how it ends. It was...
Yeah.
That's the episode to watch. Episode Home, And it's probably like the
and fifth the Ryan season. Reynolds episode, the Bloody Mary episode.
Oh, that's Ryan Reynolds, my ass. That was an accident that we stumbled upon that.
Well, that was I remember because I was telling you about the
yeah, and then we brought the Bloody Mary up, episode. And it's like,
oh, Ryan Reynolds is in this. We found the one Ryan Reynolds X-Files episode. There's so many good scary X-Files.
The episodes. Show itself is a horror show.
Yeah,
I mean,
and I love aliens. So
it's about aliens. It's about cryptids, mm-hmm. all the cryptozoological creatures and shit.
Yeah.
Any other shows you like? Supernatural.
I love Supernatural. There's first season is really scary. The fourth season of Supernatural is probably my favorite because there is so much comedy in the fourth season.
Oh, it's like a funny season?
Yeah, the episode called Scaredy Cat in season four is just hilarious, and I love it so much.
It's maybe I'll watch it tonight.
Oh, it's such a good episode.
What about this monster movie?
Oh, that is another good one. It's all in black and white. Like,
oh, you were telling me about this one.
Yeah, season four of Supernatural is like the fun season. And it's just really good.
Let me ask you this. Oh, there's one episode called Jump the Shark.
Yeah.
are there big bads in every season? So, like, Buffy the Vampire Slayer coined the phrase big bad. So, like...
Okay, so, like, one main villain
for one main season. Villain that maybe they're kind of... keeping up with the entire season, and they have a final battle like the last episode of the season.
With Supernatural, the first season has the yellow-eyed demon, which is the big bad guy, the one who kills his mom and all that, which you see in the very first episode, the first 5 minutes, and that's who they're kind of following throughout the whole first season. And then you find out that he's working for hell and all that. And
do they get him in the first season?
No spoilers, but you'd have to watch it.
Okay.
The end of the first season is pretty epic. And then they go into the whole...
so yeah, season two.
Like, season two is... right at the end of season one, you think they won, and then, bam, they get hit by a truck. And they're all in the hospital. And then first episode of season two is Dean...
Do they have three brothers?
No, just
John.
John is the dad.
Okay.
Because throughout the whole first season, they're looking for the dad.
Oh, they find him.
Yeah.
And they get hit by a truck.
Yeah, basically. And first season, episode two, Dean is in his subconscious being hunted by a reaper, basically.
Oh, this sounds cool. Everybody loves a clown.
Yeah, there's a couple of really good clown episodes. Sam in the series is horrified of clowns. So
which one's Sam?
Sam is Jared Padalecki.
Okay. And then Dean is Jensen Ackles?
Yeah.
Ackles?
Jensen Ackles.
Ackles. So is there a big bad of season two?
Well, the final one, all hell breaks loose.
Oh, so the
the yellow-eyed demon goes through... season one, they find their dad. Season two, they come face-to-face with the yellow-eyed demon. And then season three, I believe, starts the... heaven, hell.
Yeah, it looks like stuff. They gotta hunt down demons that escape from the devil's gate.
Yeah, and then season four is just fun, and season five is the really, in my mind, the show itself should have ended with season five, because the whole overarching storyline was that five seasons.
They finished their business.
They finished it, and of course the show was doing really well. So,
it's still on, isn't it?
Yeah, it's still on. They just finished the eighth season. I absolutely hated the sixth season. Because the sixth season was, okay, we finished our storyline. This was what we had to show
everybody.
So now
we need to figure
out
how to
do it. But it's doing really well. We're going to continue it. And I hated the sixth season so much. The seventh season started picking back up, and I like it again. But,
let's see here. What does it say?
The seventh season, they brought in the Leviathans, which are pretty good. Bad guys.
The man who knew too much. The wall comes down in Sam's mind, and all hell breaks loose. So what, is there some mental issues he's having?
Basically, at the end of season five, to defeat Lucifer, Sam...
Sacrifices himself. There's always a sacrifice.
Goes to hell with Lucifer. Well, he lets Lucifer possess him, and then they throw Sam into the pit. They open up the pit to hell and throw him in.
Sounds just like season five of Buffy.
Yeah.
Because they're going to kill her sister.
And it's all...
She kills herself instead.
Yeah. And it's all fairly happy. I mean, you assume Sam is dead. He's in hell, being tortured by Lucifer for the rest of eternity, and Michael, Archangel, because Lucifer was an archangel originally as well.
Right, right.
And Dean goes to his love interest, and you think it's a happy ending, even though Sam's dead. He's going to move on with his life. He's not going to be a hunter anymore. And that was, for me, the end of the series. And then the last 2 seconds of the final episode of season 5.
Sam, he's still alive!
Sam is sitting there watching Dean from the street through the window, and he's like, what? They just said that he would never be able to come out. How is he here? And then season 6, it turns out that one of the angels pulled Sam out of hell.
Last second?
While he was in there, but he only pulled his body. He didn't grab his soul, Sam was walking around without a soul.
It's kind of like that on Buffy, too,
he has
dude.
No conscience. And
so they got to track
so
that
basically
down
season 6 is them trying to get Sam's conscience back, soul back. And I just hated that season.
And so this year will be season 9 starts up pretty soon.
Season 9 starts up pretty soon, yeah. I haven't seen
season
7
yet. Time for a Wedding.
Yeah,
that's the name of the episode.
Season 7 is starting to get pretty good. I'm about halfway through season 7.
Oh, you haven't watched all these yet?
No.
So then you're behind
on
season 8 too then, huh?
You haven't seen any of season 8. The last one I saw was Party on Garth, which is 18 of 23.
That's an interesting title too. What about this one? Plucky Penny Whistle's Magic Menagerie.
That one is a clown episode.
Sam
where...
confronts his fear of clowns.
Yeah, that's a pretty good one.
Interesting. I may have to watch a couple of those 4-season episode ones
that
you were talking about.
The Monster Movie one and Scaredy Cat are the two to watch. Because the Monster Movie one, it's all in black and white, and it's got classic horror movie monsters. And then Scaredy Cat is just hilarious.
I may have to check those out.
Yeah.
What else do you watch that's horror-centric? Because there's a lot of
Fringe.
Horror TV. Fringe?
Fringe has some
scary
stuff.
Isn't that
kind
of like X-Files?
It's very much X-Files... but not aliens. It's like if X-Files is about aliens, this is X-Files about a parallel universe.
Okay. And this is on fucking Netflix too.
And that's only 5 seasons long too. So
is it over at 5?
That's over at 5. Which I think 5 seasons is perfect amount of time to get
if
a whole...
shit gets watered down after that,
yeah.
They kind of lose where their sense of direction.
Essentially, you can do it in 3 seasons. There's ABC has thrown out a new thing where they're going to be doing 1 season, 1 shots. And Hostages is a 13-episode, 1 season storyline.
That's the one with fucking Dylan McDermott. Dylan McDermott.
And that's only a 1 seasoner, and they planned it that way.
Okay,
and
that makes sense, because that show looked like...
Which I
how
think,
are they going to have an entire series about...
Which I think American Horror Story started that idea where you can have one story arc in one season and then move on. Even though American Horror Story is... It has difference. They're going to start their third season.
But it's
but
all different
all
stories.
Different stories, different actors.
No, same actors.
Same actors.
Same actors playing different parts.
Right.
It's kind of like Cloud Atlas, which
right.
I,
so
which
it's
I haven't
all,
seen.
It's basically they have their... actors
the repertory
and their
group,
their
yeah.
repertory and then they do a different story each season,
so like a
which
bad
it might
guy
be
in one
cool
season
if,
a good guy in another
yeah so it may end up being cool if after however many seasons they like oh mind blown they just tied them all together something like that which might be cool but I like the idea of just doing a one season story.
Have you watched American Horror Story?
I saw a couple episodes of the first season.
That's on here too. I really really wanted to watch that.
I couldn't get into it. The first season, everybody says the second season is really good, Asylum.
The Asylum.
And the third season is supposed to be Salem Witch Trials.
Yeah.
That should be interesting.
And you
never really see a whole lot of really awesome, really well done Salem Witch Trials stories.
Yeah, you know, I just watched fucking Lords of Salem, the Rob Zombie movie.
No good?
No, not so good.
No.
it doesn't really have a focus or a direction of where it's
no
going.
Good. It's Rob Zombie's Terrence Malick.
I guess. You know what? I haven't seen a Terrence Malick film.
New World, Terrence Malick.
I know. I've got it. I haven't watched it.
Thin Red Line.
Haven't watched it.
Tree of Life.
Haven't watched it.
Shoot. I was just looking at Terrence Malick's IMDb.
He did Badlands.
And
I really
in between
Badlands.
Badlands, I think, was his... He had two that he did. Badlands and one other one. And then in between that and Thin Red Line was like 20 years that he didn't direct anything. And now he's got like 10 in the past couple of years.
Probably needs the money.
Yeah, so from 78 to 98.
One director. Yeah, look at that. That is like 20 years.
Yeah.
Days of Heaven. Okay, that's his movie.
Lanton Mills, Badlands, Days of Heaven. And that was 78. And then boom, not till 1990, 20 years later, was Thin Red Line.
And then it was another 5, 6, 7 years between these two movies.
Yeah, New World.
And then another 6 years between these two movies. And now he's doing a few more. Like these three right here are in the same year.
Yeah.
Wow. Badlands. Like, so he did one movie.
So he's such a well-known director, but he has 5 movies that people have seen, you know?
Five movies. Yeah, isn't that weird?
Yeah, and he's such a well-known, he has such a style, well-known style, that you're like, oh, that's Terrence Malick, you know?
That's strange. That's real strange. But fuck it, right? He's able to make movies, let him do it.
Yeah. He's like the, I can't think of the actor's name right now. Last Mohicans.
Daniel Day-Lewis?
He's like Daniel Day-Lewis of directors.
Is he very, you know what? Like, I'd never seen anything that he'd done until Gangs of New York.
Right.
And then it seemed like he popped up everywhere for being like a well-known actor. I'd only ever seen one of his more later movies.
Mm-hmm.
So I never saw anything before Gangs.
So he does like one movie every couple of years, Daniel Day-Lewis.
And, well, like, from these after two, it was like 3 years. Right here, between The Boxer and Gangs in New York. See, that's why, because that's 5 years.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's a pretty big haul for, you know, that's what your job is.
Well, Last of the Mohicans was probably his biggest role to start, and that was 92.
I think My Left Foot, I think he might have won an Oscar for this in
89.
So you got My Left Foot, you got Last Mohicans, Age of Innocence is a Scorsese movie.
Mm.
And then, of course, you've got
Scorsese.
Crucible,
which is classic story. So,
Have you seen the Crucible?
Not his.
You haven't seen his?
Mm-hmm.
What have you seen? An older one? A newer one?
You know what? That 96, that probably is the one I watched in high school.
For Winona Ryder?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, that is the one I watched.
I thought that was really fucking good. I thought he was really good.
Yeah, he gets crushed to death by the stones, as John Proctor does.
I thought it was really... His speech at the end had me crying, dude. We watched that in
English class?
No. Me and Melissa took this art of film.
Oh, okay.
Plays. So we read the plays and then watched the movies.
I really love his acting. When he first gets called into the court, and Winona Ryder gives her testimony, and then he gives his testimony, and then they call in his wife, Mrs. Proctor. I forget her name. Anne?
Abby.
I don't know. Abigail. No, that's Williams. Elizabeth Proctor. But that sequence from the first testimonies, beginning with Winona Ryder and then John Proctor and then his wife, Elizabeth Proctor, that sequence was very well done in this movie, I think. And which is going to be so scary because, like,
the whole story, dude.
Getting accused wrongly and then...
It's so fucked up because it's all a bunch like of little girls and they don't know what they're fucking doing.
Yeah, and then John Proctor, he gives all the truth about in his testimony about what he did, and then the judge says, "Okay, you just said that, but let me ask your wife about that." And then his wife tries to cover up for him
because she doesn't know.
And she's like, "No." Oh, so if she had said the truth, like if she had said the truth in her original testimony, then
everything would have been fine.
The Winona, Abigail Williams, she would have probably been burned or something.
It's so fucked up. It's so fucked up because you know it's all bullshit.
Yeah. Which is very scary. That's a social horror. And I think one of my favorite social horror movies, even though it's got some monsters in it, was The Mist. The Stephen King Mist.
Yeah, because the fucking Mother Abigail, is it?
I forget.
Mother Carmody, I think.
Yeah, but that is one of the best social horror movies, I think, ever.
Mass hysteria. Like, it's like... The monsters outside, you may as well just fucking deal with them because they're going to fucking lynch you inside because they think that you're like, I don't know, going against God or something.
They throw the guy out in there, they want to throw the girl out there. She gets stung by the thing. And
Mrs. Carmody, yeah. And this guy's such a dickhead. Andre Brower.
That's a good movie.
It is a fucking
good movie. It's got William Sadler in it. I recently just, I watched the first season of, finished the first season of Roswell. And he's the sheriff in Roswell. Which I really like Roswell. I like Aliens, of course. So.
Melissa likes it. Melissa watched that show. Yeah.
I never saw it on the air. And then I saw it was on Netflix. I was like, oh, I always wanted to watch this. I was middle school, freshman in high school when it started. It was 99 when it started. And I was like, man, I want to watch this. But being that age, my parents were like, no, we're not going to watch it. Let's watch X-Files. But
yeah.
I was like, oh, okay. But just because it has all the romance in it. But
oh, is there a lot of romance in it?
There's a lot of...
It's Katherine Heigl, isn't it?
Yeah, Katherine Heigl's in it, which I didn't realize until I started watching it. And Roswell is just really good. William Sadler's really good in it.
I'm a big William Sadler fan, too. I loved him in, like... See, he's in all Frank Darabont's fucking movies.
Shawshank, Green Mile.
He was just one of the one of the convicts in that. And then in Green Mile, he was the dad of the two little girls that get killed.
Right.
Who was he in Iron Man 3? Did you see Iron Man 3?
I did see Iron Man 3.
Oh, he was the president. Oh, he was in 666 Park Avenue. That show didn't last.
Not at all.
I remember.
It was an ABC show. It never.
ABC.
I really don't like those type of ABC shows. Like, ABC show, oh, who cares? The only ABC show that I care about is Castle and Avengers, the new Avengers.
Shield.
Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. That's ABC. Like, other than that, ABC doesn't have a whole lot that I care about.
Two Guys, a Girl, and a Pizza Place. Or was that on 7? I don't know.
It was in Man on Ledge.
Did you see that?
I did see Man on Ledge.
That's the one with Sam Worthington?
Yeah. Oh, that was pretty good. I mean, it was decent. I mean, it was a pretty basic storyline. You can predict a lot of it.
Yeah, cookie cutter. Oh, look.
Yeah.
Fringe. He was in French.
That's right.
Dr. Sumner.
So he's in 2008 and 2011.
When he came back.
As Bill Sadler.
So yeah, he goes by Bill. And he's in a couple of the Tales from the Crypt.
Fallout New Vegas, he's a voice.
Video game. He's in The Pacific.
Which was that Band of Brothers sequel, basically.
Follow-up?
Yeah. Because Band of Brothers was, of course, in Europe, and then Pacific was... Of course, the Pacific, World War II.
The Japanese area, right?
Yeah.
He's an Eagle Eye. I saw Eagle Eye.
Eagle Eye is really good.
It was fun. I thought it was fun. I don't think it was a really good movie, but it was a lot of fun.
Black Donnelly's. I wish Black Donnelly's stayed on the air. I liked the Black Donnelly's TV show.
What are you... Oh, down here. Yeah. What is that?
That's like a modern Irish mob.
Oh, is it?
Yeah. Which I thought was really good, but it stopped after one season. Stopped during the first season.
Numbers is the show that I want to watch.
I can't get into Numbers. The main character, the lead of Numbers, he's too...
The actor?
The character.
Okay, because the actor is the reason why I want to watch it. Rob Morrow, I'm a big fan
from Clockstoppers.
Is he in Clockstoppers? I'm a big fan of his from Northern Exposure.
Okay, but that...
The character.
The character's too eccentric for me.
Him, right there? Oh, him. Okay, so now this is the guy I'm talking about right here.
Yeah, the main character, and then you're talking about his brother.
Okay. I assumed he was... So David Krumholtz is the character. That guy's in every fucking movie.
The Jew.
That's racist, dude.
But he's Jewish. I like Jews.
You can't say it like that.
Judd Hirsch is in there.
So David Krumholtz is the Clockstopper, then everything else.
Yeah.
Let's see here.
Which is a good actor. I just don't like that character in Numbers.
So we're still on. We're back to Bill Sadler.
And of course, that's a police crime.
Yeah.
Which there are so many.
Throw a rock and you'll hit one.
Yeah, so many crime Law and Orders. However many Law and Orders are there. How many CSI? Two NCISs. But I like NCIS.
But which is also still on.
Yeah. NCIS is pretty good, though. He was in JAG. There's the classic.
JAG, which was NCIS, was a spinoff of JAG.
Yeah. Was it a spinoff or it? But it's just JAG is, of course, Navy, and NCIS is, of course, Navy. But
JAG is about the lawyers, isn't it?
Yeah. And then NCIS is the investigators.
Yeah. And there was an episode that spun off of it, so that's where NCIS came from.
There's Roswell. So he's in all but one episode. I think there's 62 episodes total.
So was he in the first episode?
Yeah.
And then there's probably just some random, probably like bottle ship episode that he wasn't in or something.
Deep Space Nine, who is it? Sloane.
Oh, he's in a couple episodes of Deep Space Nine.
Huh.
And of course, he's in Disturbing Behavior, which is one of my favorite sci-fi horror movies.
Right.
Have you seen it?
Is that the Mark Wahlberg?
Katie Holmes. Katie Holmes, James Marsden, and the kid from Terminator 3.
I don't think I have seen it.
It's kind of like an Invasion of the Body Snatchers type thing.
Okay.
It's a town.
It's an alien thing. Is it aliens?
I'm not sure. I don't remember.
So it's aliens. I'm watching it.
It's like Disturbing Behavior and The Faculty kind of came out at the same time. Faculty kind of got a little bit.
I love The Faculty.
Disturbing Behavior is definitely the same type of movie. Yeah. It's a lot like Stepford Wives. Okay. Kind of like, you know, they've got their own society of people. It's kind of like
this is The World's End.
Did you see that yet?
I've not seen
that. It is a lot like that, but I'm not sure if it's aliens or if they've created something.
Okay.
I think they leave it open-ended.
Ooh, he's in Outer Limits episode.
Yeah, like I said, he was
Tales from the Crypt.
He's in the first movie, and then he plays the Grim Reaper, which he played in Bill and Ted. And then
he was the Grim Reaper?
In Bill and Ted, yeah.
Oh.
And then they grabbed him for the bumpers at the beginning and the end for that episode of Tales from the Crypt.
Oh, cool.
And then he was in the first episode of Tales from the Crypt.
Nice.
And there he is in Shawshank.
Haywood. What's your name? Haywood. What's your last name? Jablomi.
Haywood Jablomi.
Name that
Why do you keep calling our son Haywood?
What's his name? Haywood Jablomi.
Oh, I got it. I got it. Why is writing so fucking hard?
It's one of my favorite comedies, Hamlet 2.
He's walking around with his pants off, and the cat's sitting there. Doesn't he yell at the cat? Like, it's like, fuck you, or something.
I love that comedy. I think that Hamlet 2 is one of the loudest I've laughed inside the theaters.
Did you see it in theaters?
Yeah.
It's an amazing fucking comedy.
Yeah.
So there he is, Bill and Ted.
Die Hard 2.
Yeah, he's the bad guy in Die Hard 2.
Murphy Brown.
An episode of Murphy Brown as Bill Sadler. He's in a couple episodes of Roseanne.
St. Elsewhere.
In the Heat of the Night. Oh, God, St. Elsewhere. God, we're back in the 1980s now. Bunch of TV stuff before he jumped into movies.
Yeah.
I like this guy a lot. He's good.
Bill Sadler.
So, Walking Dead. Still haven't watched it?
I saw the first season.
Oh, you watched the whole first season?
Yeah, I saw the whole first season, which is what? Six episodes. I thought it was good. It's really gritty, really gross.
Like that?
It's really... zombies are... Like, the New Age zombies, they're supposed to be gross like that. And I thought it's really well done. I thought it was really good. I like the acting. I like the direction. I like the style of it. But I just find myself getting that sick to the stomach feeling after watching it and like, ugh.
Really?
That's sad. I don't know if I want to watch another episode right now.
I just finished fucking season 3 and probably we're recording still.
Yeah, I'm current on the books, the comics, and I thought the comics were really well. There's, of course, periods where you have like 4 or 5 issues where nothing happens and you're like, oh, okay, let's move on.
I'm current to
the latest issue was an entire issue, and all it is him, the new bad guy Negan, saying, I'm gonna kill you, and that's like an entire issue. I'm like,
really?
You spent 20 pages where you could have done this in 2. But so the books are good. There's the governor on the tank. The books are good, but some of the writing can lag a lot in the books.
And it's all the same writer, hasn't changed once.
Yeah, and I think if you condense it all, like if you did a Dragon Ball Z movie with that kind of thing, where Dragon Ball Z movie was an entire season in one movie kind of thing, if you could probably easily do that with Walking Dead, the books.
No, that's true, because when me and Melissa were watching the TV show Dragon Ball Z, we get the movies that kind of came out around the same time. I liked the movies a lot better than watching the fucking show.
It doesn't take a half hour for them to power up.
I really loved, like, the one with fucking, I think it wasn't Tree of Life. Tree of Might. No. Something like that.
Mm. And it doesn't take an entire season for him to run the road.
You know, that's such fucking bullshit, because you're sitting there watching it for 4 hours, and he's just running that fucking road.
Yeah.
Ah. But yeah, this is where I am. I'm in issue 42, current.
Yeah.
And I read this a year ago.
Right at the end of the prison, when the governor comes in with the tank.
Do they kill him? You can tell me. I don't care.
Yeah, governor dies.
Here?
In the next trade.
In the next trade?
I'm not sure if it's the next issue, but the next trade he dies.
And it looks like Dale's still alive in this issue. Is he still alive currently?
Dale does die. Yes.
They killed him off at the end of season 2. In the TV show.
He lasts a while longer.
Yeah, they kill off... They killed off fucking Andrea.
No, because he gets bit at the prison. And then they cut his leg off.
Oh, they do that with Herschel.
Oh, and it's Herschel, not Dale.
Okay, yeah, no.
Which one's Dale?
Dale... No, it looks like it's Dale. Dale's wearing the hat.
Herschel's the farm dad.
Herschel's the farm dad.
Yeah, he dies.
See, they cut off his leg in the TV show.
Oh, they cut off his leg.
They killed off Dale at the end of season 2.
Oh, okay.
So he's
using the same elements, just use different characters.
And they just killed off... Lori just got killed giving birth.
Okay. In the books, she gives birth and they have the kid for a little while.
And then they both, like, die in like a...
Which is in the next trade right after...
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Like
so
a wall crushes them or something, right?
They get shot. I think it's the very next issue after that trade.
Oh, they get shot in, like, the siege or something?
Yeah, in the siege of the governor on the prison.
And they killed Andrea just now in the last episode of season 3.
They killed Andrea?
They killed Andrea. I was so pissed off, dude. Because Andrea's still alive, right?
She and Rick are, like...
The only two.
They're only, like...
Because Andrea,
Rick,
Glenn.
And the kid.
Carl.
They're, like, the only... ones from the original.
I know. I was.
How did they kill Andrea? She's so pivotal in the books.
I thought it was stupid. I thought it was a wrong move that they killed her.
Like, she becomes a sniper in the books and she saves people. And
she's with the governor in season 3.
Oh, that she doesn't even talk. They don't even really have any contact other than one issue in the books.
No, it's completely different because her and Michonne. She gets separated from the group right after they leave the farm before going to the prison, and Michonne finds her, and they head off and find Woodbury.
Mm-hmm.
And they end up there with the governor.
How did they kill Andrea?
I know. I was pissed off about
it. Huge in the books.
I was really pissed off about it.
Oh. Was that your post, that season 3 episode?
Yeah, that was...
This is such bullshit.
It was such bullshit that they killed her off because...
Wow.
Like, that's the thing. That's the thing right there. Is Andrea is...
Like, the most recent issue, in the standoff issue with Negan. Negan is such a dick. I hate that guy. The newest bad guy in the books. And she's up in the clock tower with her sniper rifle on them. And she almost gets thrown out. She gets beat almost to death and then throws the dude out of the watchtower.
Kills him? Negan, or...?
Killing him, but it's one of the henchmen. And Rick sees it from a distance and it thinks it's her, and that he thinks that she dies. But
they're still at the prison then?
No, they're in a separate community. So after the governor ruins the governor basically ruins the prison.
Oh, does he?
Makes it unlivable.
Fucking asshole.
Yeah. He drives a tank over both fences. But yeah, the last line of the last issue so far is Andrea saying, "You and me, Rick, we survive."
Is there a time, like, it's like, how long is it from the first issue?
From the first issue to the most recent, I'd say 2 years.
2 years? Like, maybe. Is Carl getting older?
Carl's getting older. He's got long hair.
Because they don't cut their hair.
No. It starts off in the summer. They go through the one winter.
Yeah, they go through the winter right before they find the prison, right?
Yeah, and then...
when he kills Zombie Shane.
I think Negan is in the fall after the prison. So, about 2 years, I'd say.
All right, you know, we need to finish up this podcast. Let's finish it up. Let's watch. Let's see if they've got a promo for the next season of Walking Dead, and that's, we'll finish it up with that.
Trailer
and then
for I've got, season 4.
There it is, right there. For a show Greg hasn't even seen. So
how do they kill Andrea? She turns into such a badass in the comics more
than our variant. Oh, hey, that's the comic swimsuit
special, which I believe went on tonight. This is variant from the guys who make Film Riot, which is a show that I watch on YouTube. I love Film Riot. Film Riot has a new zombie movie they're making called The Outsiders, and holy crap, I'm excited for that.
So, of course, Daryl's
nowhere. He's nowhere to be found in the
books. Not in the comics. Big Spot, is that what that was? Like big lots.
Yeah. We go in, stay in formation
for the sweep. After that, you're on the list. There's Tyrese. Any questions? Is there a time you weren't the boss of me? We had a few years before I was born. So they finally brought Tyrese in. And... Finally, but it was bullshit the way it happened because they were friends.
Okay.
And then he kicks them out of the prison, and they go to Woodbury, and they're ready to fight him back. It's really weird.
Wow. It's very interesting. So they're still at the prison.
Still at the prison.
She goes crazy in the books.
Carol.
Carol goes crazy in the books.
Yeah, because they grenade launched the watchtowers near the end when the governor attacks the prison.
Right.
There's Maggie.
She's very good in Supernatural, that actress.
Oh, is she in Supernatural?
Yeah. I really like her character in Supernatural. You have to have numbers. People are the best defense against walkers or people. We need supplies. Help build up these fences. I'd like to start pulling my weight around here. Let me earn my keep. Today. She's teaching the kids, I guess.
Teach the kids how to kill zombies.
Walkers.
The governor calls them biters.
Biters.
There's Hirsch. If Woodbury was still in one piece. Yeah, but
we might be safer outside those walls. What's he looking at? What's he looking at?
What was he looking at?
Oh, man.
Oh, shit. They're going to tear the fence down.
You see this? Was someone feeding these things? Just
found its way. What? Oh, someone was feeding
the zombies
rats.
At the edge of the fence.
So there's someone taking them down from the inside.
Right.
It's gotta be that black dude that's like, I want to pull my weight around here. He obviously looks like the...
Yeah.
The weakest link.
Okay, so season 4 is still at the prison then.
Yeah, yeah. It looks like they're gonna leave it though.
Yeah. Probably halfway through.
So where do they go from the prison?
They find a new community. I forget the name of it.
With people?
Yeah. And they're like, hey, can you accept us?
Oh, Tyrese is all fucked up.
Okay, so they're doing the scene with Tyrese, which happens in the prison.
Yeah.
This happens out in the woods right there in the
show.
No,
what's funny is because Rick kind of does that in season 3.
Yeah.
Because when Laurie dies, he takes off and just starts killing zombies. And you don't know what he's doing. No, he doesn't go to the gym.
Oh, okay.
He just goes to the boiler room where she was at. But it kind of looks like that's the scene. But
right.
Like you said, they just showed it right there. Where he just fucking takes everybody out with his hammer.
Can we just take a moment to talk about how good a shot everybody is? Like, you've shot a handgun.
It's impossible.
It takes a long time to be able to shoot with one hand while moving and hit someone in the head.
and they all do
it like, oh, you pick up a gun. Every shot. Someone in the head now. Like, when they're leaving the farm... He's running, and he's looking behind him, running, and he's shooting them all in the head. I'm like, what?
It's true. It's so true. And you know, there was one scene in the season 3 where Tyrese is trying to learn how to shoot, and he's got like a sniper rifle with a scope.
Yeah.
And he misses like every shot until he's like right there.
So how did that look to you?
It looked decent. Pretty exciting. It definitely pulls away from the books, which I think they're probably going to be doing that more and more as the seasons progress. But it looks... I just like that they have a zombie TV show, you know?
And it's still gone.
And
they should have kept season 3 at 12 episodes, though.
How long was it?
It was 16.
Okay.
And there is this one episode, and I talked to Dakota about this. It probably won't be on the podcast, though. There's this one episode where Rick and the governor meet up in this neutral place to kind of try and hash things out.
Yeah.
And it was probably the most useless episode I've ever seen. It was pointless as fuck, because...
Were they in, like, a loft, a barn loft or something?
It was like a corn silo, situation. Okay. And, like, it was...
Right.
Neither of them was going to give up, you know, give in to the other one.
I've seen that in memes. Memes on Facebook.
Oh, I've never seen those.
Okay.
But it was probably like it's the most pointless episode. I felt like I wasted my time watching.
They're just gabbing at each other.
Yeah, not getting.
Dude, you stop.
Done.
No, you stop. No, you stop.
Yeah, and the governor even said, he's like, "Oh no, I'm not here to, you know, to come with a solution. I'm here for your surrender." and he's got a gun sitting right there. Like he showed up early and put a gun on the table.
Yeah.
But he never ends up using. And it just,
so it was just a waste of an episode.
It was a huge waste of an episode. Wow. And, you know, a couple of the other ones at near the end of the season, it's just like they added them on because they knew that people were going to watch them and they were going to make money from the ratings and everything. So 12 is definitely a perfect amount. And yeah. I really loved season 2. I loved season 2 so much. I thought it was so good.
Yeah.
Especially the mid-season finale.
Where they find the girl.
Where they find the girl, and I was...
Which I was upset about when I found about that, because she lasts for a long time after that, too, in the books.
So she still dies, eventually?
She still lives. She's still alive in the
books.
She's
still alive in the books, so... Yeah. Her, Carl...
Because right now, she and Maggie are at this other community that they stayed at.
Because Glenn's dead now, right?
Yeah,
he died in issue 100.
Yeah, and when that happened, Maggie and the girl, they went... to this place called the Hillside, and now they're living separate from Rick. So they don't really talk. Like, they don't really go back to Maggie a whole lot.
Okay, so she's kind of done, maybe.
For now, they'll probably bring her back when something happens.
All right. Well, with that, Greg, we've had a decent conversation here.
Yeah.
So, thanks for listening, and thanks for being here, Greg.
Yeah. Anytime.
And I'm Matthew Bonta.
I'm Greg Kleino.
Happy Halloween.